Good morning, Parkway. It's good to see all of you. I'm glad you're here this morning. My name's Stephen Olson. I'm one of the associate pastors here. I got to ask you guys, I'm kind of new to Grants Pass, so I got to ask you, what's up with this fog? I mean, is this a normal thing in the winter? Okay. And what's the science here? Because, like, I lived in Medford the last 3 years, and we didn't get this much fog. So how come it's foggier here than in Medford? Anybody know the answer? The river? Really? The river makes that much of a difference? Somebody else told me it was, like, because we're a smaller bowl here, and so it blows out less or something. I don't know. All I know is that sometime during this morning, you know, during worship or the sermon, be praying with me that the fog will blow away. Okay, let's just make that a priority at our worship service this morning. Pray for the fog to head out. Let's go ahead and have the worship team and prayer team come on up. I want to read Psalm 68, verses 4 through 6 as we start our worship time. And this is especially good because today we're going to be hearing about our pregnancy care center here in Grants Pass, which is an awesome ministry. So be thinking about that, and as we read these verses, also be thinking there's lots of categories here of different people and how God helps them, and maybe try to identify with one of these categories of people that God helps. I think all of us could fit into one or more of these categories. So Psalm 68, verses 4 through 6. Sing to God, sing in praise of his name. Extol him who rides on the clouds. Rejoice before him, his name is the Lord. A father to the fatherless, a defender of widows, is God in his holy dwelling. God sets the lonely in families. He leads out the prisoners with singing, but the rebellious live in a sun-scorched land. I love that for what we're going to be talking about this morning, how God is using our pregnancy care center to reach out to hurting women in our community. And I also like that verse 6, God sets the lonely in families, because it reminds me that we're all kind of lonely, but God's brought us all into this church family together, and this church is one way that God sets the lonely in families. So as we come together, we can praise God for doing that for all of us, for putting us in this church family. Let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll start to worship. Dear Lord, we thank you for what you've done for each one of us. Thank you for what you've done for other people. And we thank you for giving us each other. Thank you for this church. Thank you that we could all be wandering sheep and lost and scared, but you've gathered us together into your community, your fold. So we come together today to worship you for what you've done, for all the things that you've done in our lives. Amen.
Champion of heaven. have heard the song of love that you sing. Oh, so I will let you draw me out beyond the shore into your grace. Oh, your grace and your love and wave after wave crashes over me, crashes over me. For you are for us, you are not against us, champion of heaven.
Nothing compares to your end. Make that your prayer.
No other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus.
Sing your peace.
You are peace, you are peace. When my fear is crippling, you are true, you are true. Even in my wandering, you are joy, you are joy. You're the reason that I sing. You are life, you are life. Death has lost its sting.
Come on. Hope secure. He
The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. The God who called me here below will be forever mine. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like the flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship Your holy name.
Worship His holy name.
your holy name. I will worship your holy name. I will worship your holy name.
As we've sung this morning, I've been thinking about the joy that God gives us as we've been singing about Jesus conquering death and conquering Satan. And several times during worship there, we all just yelled and clapped, and I think Jesus loves that. He loves us celebrating because he's given us joy, and Jesus is full of joy. In Luke 10, Jesus sent out 72, and then they came back full of joy and said, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." And Jesus replied, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." Then he says, "Do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." And then it goes on to say, Jesus, full of joy through the Holy Spirit, said, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do." So I just love that picture of us rejoicing in Jesus and Jesus being full of joy because we're happy. And I think that's Jesus' thought right now as we worship him with joy. Go ahead and greet one another with joy this morning. Chatty bunch this morning. I got a few announcements for you. First of all, if you're new here to Parkway, I just want to say welcome. I'm glad you're here. And in your bulletin, we have these next step cards. And on one side of those, it has a little place that says prayer request. And I just want to throw that out there. We love to pray for everybody in our church. And if you're new and you have a prayer request, write it on there and turn it into the offering at the end of church, and we'll pray for you. But welcome to Parkway. What'd you say? What if you're old? How does that make any difference? If you're old, do the same thing. If you have a prayer request, write it on there. We'll pray for old people too. Don't know what to do with that, you know. Wildflowers is starting on Tuesday, January 20th from 6 to 8:30 in the prayer room. And there's an application in your bulletin if you're interested in joining them. Wildflowers is a support group for women who have suffered the trauma of childhood sexual abuse. And it's a safe, supportive and confidential environment. So I encourage you, if you've been sexually abused in the past, fill out that application and get in that group. It'll do good for you. You can turn those applications into the info desk or to the church office. Cambodia is coming up. I am leading the missions trip to Cambodia this year. Several of you have asked me about it. I don't have too many details for the trip yet, but I want to throw it out there. It's going to probably be in the second half of August, and in the past, the trip has cost around $2,100, and we go and we're in part of this 5-year commitment to help plant a church in Cambodia where the church has never been planted before, and where lots of people haven't even heard the name of Jesus. So this is a great thing, and I wanted to throw it out there this morning because I know that God has in mind for some of you to go on that trip. And so I'll get the details to you in a few weeks. You know, we'll have the registration form and the actual dates and costs and all that, but I want to throw it out there now because I know God wants to start to work in some of your hearts to go on that trip. It's a great trip. It does a lot of good things, so keep that in mind. February 8th, we're going to have our care group sign up. And we're starting several new care groups. I'm really excited about it. And this is a date change. We were going to launch these January 25th. We're pushing it back a couple weeks to February 8th. And lots of you get in touch with me in different ways and tell me you want to be in a care group, and that is so awesome. I'm so excited. The best way to get into a care group is to come to church on Sunday, February 8th, and you'll be able to check a little box and go, and we're going to go to the fellowship hall and meet the new care group leaders and hosts, and it's going to be set up kind of like Costco on a busy Saturday. We're going to have a bunch of sample tables, so I haven't quite figured out a name for it, maybe like care group samples or care group sampler, because all the leaders will be behind little booths, and you can go, you know, drink some Kool-Aid or try some Gouda cheese or something, and just see the faces of our new care group leaders and hosts, and maybe make a connection so that you'll join their group. And last, after church today, we also get to party in the fellowship hall. We're going to celebrate Jamie Zalembo. She's been a youth pastor here for 7 years, something like that, and she's done an incredible job. She's going to stay here at Parkway, which is awesome, but she's stepping down from her role as youth pastor, and we want to honor her for all the work she's given to our youth. Jamie's an incredible woman. So, we get to celebrate by eating a bunch of food in her honor after church today in the fellowship hall. It's my favorite way to celebrate somebody is by eating food. Oh, it's in the whole center. Just kidding. Thank you. I'm glad you guys aren't afraid to yell at me if I make a mistake. That'd be bad if I let something like that slip. It's in the whole center. All right. And I do have an announcement that isn't official. Pastor Dennis and Jeanette celebrated 29 years of marriage yesterday. That's a long time. What? 39? Okay, so they're 10 years older than I thought they were. 39. Well, that's even better than 29. So 39. That's awesome. So congratulations. And let's give a hand for Pastor Dennis as he comes up.
Are we dismissing the kids? I got one.
You got one.
Thanks. You guys ready?
We are.
All right. Hey, if you're in elementary school, you know who you are, first through fifth grade. Come on down. Drake, you don't get to go. Yeah, he's too old. What do you guys got going today? Is today like pie in the face day, ice cream sundae day, swim day? None of those? All right. Every once in a while, they get something wild and crazy going on over there. Yeah, they're all behaving themselves today. All right. Can you remember when you were that age? Yeah, some of you can't. We're going to pray for you. Is that all right? We're good? Okay, guys, thanks. Father, I thank you for every life that is here, created in your image, destined for a place of ministry in your kingdom. I pray, Father, that you would help them to discover that, that they would connect with you in ways that are more passionate than we could have ever hoped for, and at the same time, they would connect with you in ways of understanding that show them a path that their life should go on. We thank you for their lives and ask that you would bless them today. In your name we pray. Amen. 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 Bless you guys. Have a good time. Hey, a couple things I wanted to talk to you about. In your bulletin, you got this Bible reading plan. Did you see this? Did you understand it? Yeah. Those of you that didn't mind answering. Those of you that didn't are just shaking your heads going, I'm so confused. So there's two Bible reading plans in here for you to be able to follow. So if you just take it and open it up, you'll see one that says Project 51, New Testament and Psalms. This is the one that we mentioned to you a couple of weeks ago, where if you follow this, and you can just check the boxes as you go, but if you get in sync, what you'll discover is that you're reading through the New Testament Monday through Friday, and on Saturday and Sunday, you are reading Psalms in preparation for worship in this environment. Okay, so that's how this plan is laid out. So if you just open it up to the middle section, what you will get is the New Testament and Psalms, and it will just take you through basically a chapter a day. And a chapter a day in that plan will take you through the New Testament and through the book of Psalms, and it will also, as I said, kind of sync up with a sense of New Testament during the week, Psalms on the weekend. If you open up the full flyer, this is the chronological read through the Bible from beginning to end, from how it started to how it's going to end. Okay, so you start in Genesis, you go to Revelation. It's as true as we can kind of get chronologically. Some of you are going to look at that and go, wait a minute, how can we jump to Job? Okay, our best guess is that Job happens very, very early in history. So that's not where it is in the Bible, right? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 Samuel, 1 Samuel, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job. Takes a while to get there, right? But we believe that its date, that the historical record would show that it's early on. So that's why you read Genesis and you get kind of the opening part and then you jump to the story of Job. And these are numbered according to the days, right? So today is day 11, Job 29 through 31. Do you see how that works? Okay, how many of you don't have paper? This is now your Bible, this is now your phone, this is now your calendar, this is now everything about your life. Some of you? You can go to the App Store and you can buy the Parkway Christian Center app. Well, actually, you can get it for free. We had to pay for it, you can get it for free. That's how that works. If you get the Parkway Christian Center app, download that, you go to the bottom of the page, and there's a little thing that says Bible. If you can't see that little thing, you should get a bigger tablet so that you can't use, in case you can't use your phone. But if you do this, what you will find is that the chronological through the Bible reading is also listed on the app. Okay, so you can pick it up on your app. You can go and look at the date and go, okay, January 11th, Sunday, there's the Job. Okay, I got it. And you can follow along and use the Parkway Christian Center app. Also on there, on our app, you also can download the sermon notes, the same things that are in the bulletin, the stuff that all the care group leaders get. All of those notes, all the sermon information is going to be on the app as well. So for those of you that would rather do it electronically and have reading glasses so you can see your screen, or have figured out how to enlarge the font, you can use the Bible reading app on your phone. All right? So that's how all of this stuff's going to work. So we have it in paper form. If you want to use that, we've got it on the app if you want to use it that way, and you can keep up with the Bible reading plan. One of the things that you'll notice on your next step card, did you see that in the bulletin, the little gray sheet that's in your bulletin? That one of the things we would like to ask you to do is, if you're going to use the chronological reading through the entire Bible in a year, if you're going to use that plan, we've named it after Braden Pennington, who's sitting right there. Braden, say hi. Wait, there's Braden right there. So Braden is, are you in eighth grade this year? Yeah, last year as a seventh grader, read through the entire Bible. Just start on page one and go to page whatever, and got all the way through, and we're kind of following his inspiration. And so those of you that want to read the entire Bible this year, Braden is going to be sending you little email notes every week, kind of a little update and then some encouragement and some accountability in your Bible reading plan. So on that next step card, if you'd like to sign up, it takes an email address. We're not going to mail you a card. You will get an email. If you sign up, use an email address, and Braden will be sending out notes. Send out the first one this week, and hopefully keep everybody going. Braden's a week ahead of us, so that he can encourage those of us that are following him along and remind us of what we're doing. But so if you, we'd like to encourage you to do that and to sign up and be a part of that. And I'm talking to myself at this point because I haven't done that yet. I haven't signed up, so I got to do that. I got to get this. That way I don't want to miss my email, you know. So I got to sign up and be a part of that. In your bulletin, there are some kind of open space today, and I want you to use that to jot down some thoughts. We, at the first of the year, usually have Robin Fuller come, and as most of you know, she's the director of the Pregnancy Care Center, when she's not just here being Robin. We have her come, and she gives us a little update on what's happening at the Pregnancy Care Center. And there's some new programming and some things that we'd like to share with you that are a little more comprehensive than that today. And so I want you to be listening for how God would have you to respond if there are things that capture your attention and go, that's significant, I need to be praying about that. That's an important thing that's happening in our community. I need to be supportive of that. I want to get included in that. I want you just to be listening with intentionality this morning. And as you listen intentionally, I want you to just to take that space that's in the bulletin there and jot down some notes to yourself about, oh yeah, I'm going to remember to pray about that. I'm going to remember to be involved in that. I want to be a part of what's going on. So I want to invite Robin and Brittany to come on up, and we're going to sit over here and talk a little bit about what's going on. Just getting ready, huh? Okay, then. For those of you that don't know, that one over there is Robin, and this is Brittany over here. So keep them straight. Robin is the executive director, president, queen of the Pregnancy Care Center. I'm exactly sure what your title is. Brittany's like chief of staff, that's person in charge, responsible to make sure that Robin gets her work done. Whatever your title is exactly, that's Brittany's title. So, Robin, let's just start with give us an update. What's going on at the Pregnancy Care Center? What are you guys doing? What are the programs? Remind us.
Okay, update. We have four primary areas of service that I will remind everyone of, and PowerPoint, because that will remind me what I'm saying. Oh, it's up there. Oh, there we go. Okay. The first thing that we do is we promote abstinence to not only youth, but anyone outside, abstinence until marriage. And abstinence until you are married, regardless of what age you are. We're really working to reach teenagers, middle school and high school, hoping to encourage them that abstinence not only is a choice, it's a reality and can be a reality. And if you follow God's plan for sex, you're gonna avoid a lot of pitfalls and a lot of struggles. And I can show you a slide with some information on some of the things that may be shocking to some of you that you can read on here. What's happening when it comes just to disease and sex in our country is pretty astounding. These are just some of the numbers. But yeah, we need to reach our kids. So we have a program that Brittany helped write that we're going to talk about called EPIC, which is in right now every middle and high school in Josephine County and some of the neighboring counties as well. And we also bring the silver ring thing to town every year. So if you ever see those silver rings on some of these kids and they're wearing them, that's what that is. So that's the first thing that we're doing. The next thing that we do is we try to reach out to those women, you know, those women who are facing that unplanned pregnancy that comes at an inopportune time. It's not right timing. There's embarrassment, there's shame, and we work with them and try to encourage them to choose life for that child. And some of these women are facing really difficult situations that we're working with. It's not what some of us would think, the young unmarried woman. Sometimes they're older and unmarried and they're in some pretty difficult circumstances. So we encourage that. And another slide I can show that just shows a few stats about abortion. You know, the abortion rates in Oregon are the lowest that they've been since 1973. It's a good thing. Women still are having abortions, though, and Oregon truly is the only state in the nation that has no restrictions on abortion at all. So any one female of any age can have an abortion without her parents or anyone else knowing. There's nothing. And just so you know, we have battled, many of you know, that pregnancy centers in Oregon have battled legislation against our very efforts. Three different times since 2007. We know legislation is coming again in 2015. We're just waiting to try to find what it is this time. And as you guys know, the legislative makeup up in Salem is not very favorable toward anything that is godly right now. So we know that's coming, so please pray for us. Abortion is legal throughout all 9 months of pregnancy. If you don't know that, I still like to throw that out. And about 70% of women who have abortions attend a Protestant or Catholic church. So pretty big stuff. The third thing that we do for those women who choose life is we really want to help and be good parents. We really want to help them walk through what does that look like. And our program is called Pathways now, and we're working on creating a group class. Brittany's also working with us on that as our office manager. And then the fourth thing that we do is we work with women and men who have abortions in their past. And our program is called Journey. Now it was called Forgiven and Set Free before. We're rocking and rolling. We did more classes in 2014 than we have ever done in the history of the organization. And it's something I really encourage anyone, if you have had an abortion and you want to go through this, it's confidential. No one will know. So that is what we've done. And EPIC is one of the most exciting things that has come out of our organization in 25 years. This is a program that Brittany helped write, and we redefined abstinence, and it has been welcomed into the schools. It's pretty exciting.
Well, Brittany, we want to talk a little bit about the EPIC program and your involvement with that. It comes out of, as you were sharing with me, kind of an understanding of what you've come to perceive about sexuality and God's intent for that and how we were created. You want to just share some of those thoughts, that kind of that framework maybe that the EPIC program kind of functions inside of, about what your kind of passionate perspective is about sexuality in us humans.
Yeah. When I first came on board at Pregnancy Care Center, I sat through like a mock presentation of one of our new presenters in a program we were doing called Stop and Think, and had been in a lot of the schools for a while. And I sat there and I listened, and some of the lessons in there, I mean, it was all I could do to contain myself thinking, if I had learned these lessons when I was a young girl, how my life would have been different. And at the same time, I'm watching going, gosh, the way this is happening, the questions, the body language, the conversation, I would have wrote this presenter off in the first 5 minutes. I would not have listened. I would have not have gotten this amazing message, because I was the kid making every wrong decision you can imagine. And I would have not been able to relate. And so as much as I adored it and I saw the value in it, as much as I wanted to change it, and I'm so lucky to have been given that opportunity. So we purchased that program, took the best parts of it, and then rewrote the rest and added a lot to it. So the core lessons are the same. You know, we really talked to them about a realistic perspective on early sexual activity and the impact of that on your goals. But we decided to start with inviting them, encouraging kids, inspiring kids to care enough about their life to make goals in the first place, to make realistic goals that they had a plan for, an individual plan. And then once we'd motivated them to actually care and activate, then we start talking to them about how sexual activity can interrupt their, you know, their path. And we really beefed up the portion on character development, because realizing that no matter how old you are or what stage of your life, character development is really at the center of being able to pursue great things in your life. And then we give them actual tools on how to do that. So we give them ideas on how to date in a way that, you know, protects their purity, and ways to exit stressful situations and things like that. So basically took the program and thought, okay, well, what would have worked for me? And I was lucky enough to have a teen daughter at the time too, who was really in the middle of it. And so I got to really put those things into practice at home, and so it was good, you know, it works. And so the reason why I feel so passionately about that is because, like I said, I was really the kid who did, I mean, everything you don't want your child to do. I had her when I was 17. I got pregnant with her when I was 16. And I ended up there because I grew up in a home that wasn't Christian, in an environment that wasn't Christian, and everything that I really knew about Christians was hypocrisy, rules that were confining and restrictive, and statements and doctrines that seemed to counter, like, they didn't make sense. You know, you say Jesus is this, and then you say this, and that doesn't make sense. So the opposite of loving arms. So I ran into any loving arm that I could find. And I, that was generally people with no standards. And so I adopted that as well. Just no standards at all. When I was, I think, 14, right? Says, I got a tattoo on my ankle that says, sometimes, because I thought, oh, that's a good answer for anything. And that's the way to live, you know? No restrictions of any kind. And I saw some girls who did, who had standards, who had, you know, a bar set, but because I saw myself as less than average even, I really didn't think I could afford to have those kind of standards. And so I decided to go with the wild girl way to get attention, and I got really good at flirting and getting sexual attention from guys. So even if they didn't want to spend their life with me, at least it would be something, and maybe I'd hook one sooner or later was my plan. So at 16, I ended up pregnant, and things didn't get better then, because that didn't teach me any lessons. I mean, I was suffering the consequences, but it didn't make me any more equipped to handle the future. And I was dragging a little baby along with me, which wasn't helpful. I didn't have the skills to hold on to a job. I had no self-control of any kind. So I didn't like something my boss did. I let them know, and that didn't work out very well in a workplace. So finally, you know, desperate enough situation, I ended up utilizing my flirtation skills, and I became a dancer. It's my longest job I ever had. I was a dancer for 4 years, and
we're getting close to breaking that.
Yeah. I got into it because again, there were open arms. The first day I walked in, all of a sudden, people are wanting to pay me just to have a conversation with me. And it felt amazing. And and the open arms, the loving environment, the like, absolutely, come in, we love you, you're our new best friend. And it was great. I loved that environment for a long time. It was thrilling. I had such a sense of identity. And then, you know, when you're a part of that life, though, things start to catch up to you. And I was in a really abusive relationship. And one day, he cheated on me a lot. And he started to like a girl from this church. And so he started coming here. And I knew it was because of that girl, so I decided to come spy on him one day. And that's how I ended up here at Parkway. And he wasn't here that day, but Tim and Debbie Howe were. So that my first day here, Tim came right up to me, and he met me, and he asked if he could take down my contact information so he could get in touch with me in the week after, you know, we talked a little bit. And I'm really glad that he did, because he invited me to go to a home group and kept inviting me. And so I started going, and there I found what I'd always looked for, which were open arms, people who loved me and didn't judge me. But I'd never seen that in a Christian before. That was more usually, like I said, people with no standards. And in this, it was the opposite. It was a room full of people that truly loved me. And Robin and Steve were there. That's when I first met them. And Steve and Tim Howe had a funny way of just, I mean, no matter what skeptical questions that I would bring up, which were constant, and for a long time, they didn't get bogged down with me. They didn't like, oh, Brittany again, like, just come on already. I wasn't treated like I was a project. They weren't marking my milestones and waiting for me to, you know, get there. They were just loving me and loving the process. They were excited about it. When I would ask a question that challenged them, they would be like, ooh, I don't know. I'm meeting with Pastor Dennis tomorrow, though, and I'm going to get that. And the next week, they were so excited. It was like they used that to grow themselves, and they shared it with me instead. It wasn't, I didn't feel like I was being counted or judged or anything else. I was truly treated like an equal, even though they knew what my lifestyle was. My lifestyle didn't change because of that. And then, should I just keep talking?
Yeah.
Okay. Remember how we talked about that whole thing? Like, yeah. I'll keep talking.
As long as you're on track, I won't interrupt.
So, I didn't make it to church very often, because as I started letting God's truth in my life, it started making the dark parts of my life look dark and feel dark, and it got harder and harder to be on both sides of that. And I was drinking a lot and using a lot of drugs at the time, and most of the time at work, so that I could make it through the night, because I couldn't really be like this fun, wild, no inhibitions person anymore, because there was light growing inside of me and I couldn't do it. And so Sunday mornings were usually about nursing a hangover. But once in a while I made it to church, and one day I did, and I was sitting right back there, and I just, you know, when you come to church, like today in the worship service, it's like everything is about you and the songs are just made for you. It was one of those days, and I was just bawling and bawling, like embarrassingly bawling, you know, and I couldn't get a hold of myself, so I was going to leave. I started to leave, and this lady, I'm not 100% sure who it was still, but someone came down, and she was a stranger to me, and she just wrapped her arms around me, and she said, don't go. You're brave. You're braver than you think, and God's giving you what you need there. And she prayed with me, and I was bawling even more, so I still wanted to leave, and I thought I was leaving, but instead,
you know, it's up here, and Tim Howe again, always, you know, and he just wrapped his arms around me and he said, it's time to take that leap of faith. And so that day I decided to not go back to work, and I didn't, but I was scared because I had never held a job before. I didn't have another one. I was a single mom, and but I got the job I wanted really, really bad that I tried to get. I got it that week, and I was a waitress at a nice restaurant in town, and then that Friday night, the Fashings and the Fullers and the Bogarts and Bushnells, they came in. They were my home group, and they came in, and they tipped me enough to pay my whole rent. And it was the first time that anyone had really, like, I knew I was going to be taken care of. I knew it was going to be okay. And so things didn't get all better overnight. I still didn't have any idea how to walk it out. I didn't know how to make good decisions or have any self-control. I still had so many questions. I didn't understand the power of prayer at all. And I was still living in a lot of sin, but I was trying, and no matter how well I did on that, it didn't change the way people loved me. You guys loved me. And so I still had another child. I was teaching Sunday school here and got pregnant again. But I wasn't kicked out of Sunday school teaching. No one set me down and made sure I knew I was sinning. No one did any of that. Everyone continued to love me and be there for me anytime I needed it and treated me as a sister. And nothing had ever moved me the way that had before. And so when I sat through that Stop and Think presentation, I was and really worked through writing this new program. I just wanted to know that we could reach the kids who felt like they couldn't afford to have standards, so we could reach the kids who had no one speaking truth into their life, and reach the girls who their identity was wrapped up in sexual appeal. And that's what we've done. Our program is that now. It's amazing. And we did this a couple years ago, revamped this, and now we have a new presenter she's taught high school for the last 10 years, and she just has a way in the classroom. She's elevated the program to be smooth and clear, and she's brought a professionalism to the program that's amazing. And she teaches it now in schools, and I'd say my favorite part of this journey has been watching the fruit of it in my own home and with my daughter. She has become everything that I wasn't. She's strong and beautiful and brave, and I'm just so thankful that God placed me in this body, and that I met Robin, and that I ended up at Pregnancy Care Center, and everything he has done in my life, I've been able to give back, and I'm just so thankful.
Yeah. I think there's a point of, I mean, besides just being a marvelous story, and thanks. But I think there's a place of insight here for us. You talk about being a young lady who didn't feel she could afford to have standards. Mm-hmm. Because much of what we hear in the public discussion is management of consequences. Let's have this program that manages this consequence. Let's have this program that manages this consequence. And we can't expect our young people to have these kinds of values. It's unrealistic to believe that they would have these kind of values. But if I'm an adult who still thinks I can't afford to have standards, I'm going to transmit that and say that this 15-year-old can't afford to have standards because I'm 40 and I can't afford to have standards. I mean, they're going to just transmit that same value system. How does EPIC try to speak to that? I mean, because that's part of the beauty of the fact is that it wasn't from somebody who'd never been where you had been that tried to write the program. You were able to write the program from that perspective. How are you able to put that idea across to someone that you can afford to have standards? Because that's huge. Because without that, all of the things that we say about you could live this kind of life and you could be this kind of person and you wouldn't have to face these kind of consequences isn't going to connect.
Right.
So how does EPIC connect?
Well, first of all, we've just in the messaging, when we were doing a lot of research, or when I first came on board, there's a lot of like fear and shame and consequence-based teaching out there to try to reach kids, and it's not enough, because if kids don't care enough about themselves, their future. So that's what we kind of start off with. I mean, really validate where they are and their perspective without any judgment or shame. So we try really hard not to, you know, when kids say shocking things, we validate it and know who you are. And we do whatever we can to kind of sneak in truth in a way that isn't condemning, it's inspiring. So in our character development section, we ask kids to how would you like to be described as a person? What do you really want? And of course, we put all the fruit of the Spirit in there. And kids who don't know Jesus at all, they want those things in them. And so by even just making those tiny goals, and then we talk to them about, okay, so what people in your life are helping support that, helping you grow in that? Do you know someone like that? Do you know someone that you can start a friendship or a relationship with that will help you to grow in that way? What are you doing in your life? What decisions are you doing that are getting you closer to being that person? And so it's having steps to do that. It's little steps. So we talk about, in the goal setting portion, we talk about what do you want to do right now? Not, I want to be doctor someday. It's what do you want to do right now in eighth grade? Let's set some goals right now. And then let's make some steps to get there. Who's going to help you get there? What decisions are you making right now? Are they getting you closer or farther away? So it's really hand-holding them through those most basic processes where they feel inspired at the end of the program. And we share personal testimonies, and we have videos, and also our presenter shares. And so connecting with them personally and knowing someone who's living the life that they want to live. And
yeah, and Robin, could you put that EPIC logo up there, but the bigger one?
Yeah, the whole premise behind where our name and our logo came from was actually from you, Dennis. It was, you did a sermon, and you were really talking about how when you're on a ship out in the ocean and you make a 1 degree change that doesn't seem like a lot right now, you end up in a completely different destination than if you'd kept on course. And that's what we're trying to do, is we're trying to make a 1 degree change, a change that gives them that internal voice and that they feel safe to start listening to it. We're there for a week generally in the class every week, and it's a dialogue. So we're asking kids to really share and be open, and in most cases they really do. And
we obviously can't, in the public schools, can't talk about God, but truth is truth, and God's truth is truth whether we use his name or not.
Right.
Yeah, one of the phrases that I use is that all truth is God's truth. You know, so at whatever point somebody finally discovers what's really true, God knew it all along. Mm-hmm. And we'll use that and we'll say, here's truth, and we want you to get that. And I hope that people are connecting the dots between what you're trying to put together in that EPIC program and what happened to you personally. Because your story is of some people coming along And, you know, back to one of my favorite quotes from Don Quixote, is it madness to see other people not as they are, but as they were meant to be? Mm-hmm. That when you see people the way they were meant to be, and you begin to help them make those course adjustments. Because as you describe your story, here's a series of course adjustments that started to be made, and some were rewarding and at the time, and some were difficult at the time, but you're making these course adjustments, and there are people that are just rewarding the progress.
Yeah.
And that's such a huge thing. And I think that's one of the struggles that we have when you talk about people who can't afford to have values, and then you talk about people who now believe they can have values. I think it's hard for, when you come from a value framework, it's hard to interact with a non-valued framework in a way that's not judgmental, or in a way that says we only reward the end. We only reward success. We don't reward progress, because we have this framework of values that says when you get over here, you're good. And when you're over here, you're messed up, and we have trouble with the transitions in between. Mm-hmm. And it seems like that your story talks a lot about those transitions and moving across from one to the other. When did it dawn on you that you could be a person, you could be a girl who could afford to have values?
Good question.
I guess it was a progressive thing. Uh-huh. I remember when I was really kind of living this dual life, and at first people were really shocked when I would say I was going to church, because I, you know, at a strip club, and be like, yeah, I've got church tonight, so we need to go, like home group, you know, and people were really shocked. And I was going to school at RCC at that time, and you know, I smoked still and all those things, and people were really surprised. And at some point, I realized I just don't want people to be surprised anymore. I just don't. And that's when I decided to get baptized, and I wanted people to be surprised at my other life instead. And I think that was a moment for me that I really can be the one that they're surprised about. And then, yeah.
Yeah. So how does that now reframe your perspective on sexuality? Because we kind of know where it came from. Your original framework was kind of valueless, in the sense that it didn't have standards. And I'm, you know, I'm familiar with that. I when I was youth pastor here in Grants Pass back in the olden days, I would tell parents, you tell me where your student eats for lunch, and I'll tell you how they're doing spiritually. Yeah. Because there were definite groups. And so these groups met here, and these groups met here, and these groups met here. And in those days, it was the proverbial Hodges Corner. And Hodges is gone, and it's, you know, and that place doesn't even exist anymore. It's now the district office. It used to be a place. And the kids that kind of felt like they could afford to have value, and I love that phrase, they could afford to have values. Mm-hmm. Would eat inside. The kids who didn't feel like they could afford to have values smoked outside.
Yes, we did.
You were at Hodges.
No.
Yeah, okay. But there was a reality about that. And even then, I began to recognize that part of the reason that some of those students were there was because it was the easiest group to get into. They didn't have to be an athlete. They didn't have to be an academic scholar. They didn't have to, you know, be a musician or whatever. That you didn't have to qualify. Every other group, you had to qualify.
Yes.
I mean, you couldn't be in National Honor Society and flunk out of class. I mean, you had to qualify. You know, you couldn't be an athlete and not make the team. You had to qualify. But at Hodges Corner, you didn't have to qualify. You just had to show up. And if you were willing to show up, you were part of the group. So I began to get that. I was watching it from the outside. You've so much more clearly articulated what it's like to live inside that. But how does that now form your view of sexuality? What is it that you get with a value-based look at yourself in regards to sexuality?
That's another long question. Well, I can add something. You know, we both had very different childhoods. I came from the loving, Christian, godly home, and still made really bad choices and decisions. I think in the EPIC program and in general in our organization, and I know with Seth and Jamie, and you know, our heart's cry for our youth is that they can realize from a younger age their value, and that we really believe they can live a different lifestyle than we chose. They can do this. They can do this, and we're their biggest cheerleaders, and we will be their biggest cheerleaders. And to introduce them to a God who is not condemning or is not standing over you ready to beat you up, but a God that loves you so much, and because he loves you so much, you can choose a different lifestyle. Mm-hmm. You can choose to be his.
Mm-hmm.
So, what I try to do with the EPIC program is to challenge kids about their identity being separate from sexuality. So we challenge the lies of the enemy that are what kids are hearing. When I was in school, in Cave Junction, and we had the whole full, you know, what did they call that? Where you have the full sex ed, like everything. And all that did was give me tools to make more bad decisions. And I believed so many lies. And so that's what we do, is we challenge those. Like, we ask kids, and we have a long conversation about what is so great about being sexually active as a teenager. We don't flinch or go, oh, well, really? No, we validate that. There are really big positives. And then let's be really honest about the drawbacks. And then you decide, what's more important? What's more lasting? What's going to get you closer to be the person who you really want to be? And so it's challenging them in their critical thinking skills. How are you getting to this idea that you have? Are you sure about it? Let's walk through it and make sure that this is how you really feel. And it's not about how I feel or about how the person next to you feels. It's just how you feel. And challenging that thought process is what gets people to come to their own conclusions and to find their own truth. And like you said, there's only one truth. So,
yeah.
As far as my view on sexuality, that's one of those things that it's been a growing experience for sure. And it wasn't, even last year I went through a marriage workshop at my church, and realizing truly God's design for sex and what it's supposed to be, and how it's supposed to involve God. Like, this is something he created. And everything that goes along with that, without realizing that and understanding that, it was difficult to disconnect. And also even difficult to understand the true value of marriage. And we do a little bit of that in EPIC. We challenge, like, the, you know, popular, misconceptions about marriage. We talk about what is, you know, the media say about it, and what do you think? Like, if you were to ever want to be married, what would you think would, you know, be the important part of that, or what would you like most? And get them to dream about it a little bit, to just, instead of being the kid who I never want to get married or married people have no fun, it's getting excited about, well, what if you could create marriage how you wanted it? What would it be like? And it's taking those first few steps into believing something better is out there than what you're being told in every other place. And that's the thing, is that, you know, we know that the more we tell kids God's truth, or more we guide kids to find out God's truth on their own, then the next time they're told God's truth, maybe that's, you know, they were invited to youth group or something and they're hearing the same message, they're going to be able to relate that back. Those seeds are going to be planted. And they're going to, those are going to know, you know. Just really quick about seeds is, you know, I didn't grow up in a Christian home at all, but my mom was enough of a Christian that she prayed with me when I was scared about a test or I had a bad dream. And that was it. Let me tell you, that saved my life quite a few times, just having that one seed planted. And even if I didn't know, I didn't even believe Jesus was real. So I don't know who I was praying to, but it was those seeds that were planted that saved my life. And that's what we have to believe, that we are planting those seeds and they will have fruit because they're God's seeds. And we know that. So we don't measure success on decisions for abstinence at the end of the week. We measure success in, did kids see God's truth today?
Well, and oftentimes they may not remember what the presenter talked about, but I'm telling you, Stacy, who's not here today, who is our presenter, she loves Jesus with her whole heart. And if nothing else, we hope that those students say, I want what she has, because they see in her hope and truth and joy and love and the things that these kids who don't even know Jesus, they want those same things.
Mm-hmm. And the incredibly non-judgmental approach. There's no way, you know, the kid sits through our program and feels like Stacy judged them or, didn't like them or anything like that. You know, it's the environment that is like the home group I was in.
Even one of the videos that we show has different testimonies of people who have chosen an abstinent lifestyle or chose to be abstinent until they got married. And one of the gals in the video says, it's never too late to choose abstinence. And that's what we want them to know. It's never too late. And they can always make that choice at any time.
Right. Well, and hopefully you can, again, connect some dots here in terms of why we do some of the things that we do at Parkway. So why we work with Royal Family Kids. Because what sits at the core of the behaviors that we know are self-destructive is this, and again, I just love the way you put that, kids who don't think they can afford to have values. The risk of having values is too great. I'm going to end up alone. Nobody's going to like me. I'm not going to be able to survive at home. Whatever. I mean, they see a threat, and to have values is to challenge that. They don't think they have the strength. They don't think they have the ability to do that. And certainly one of the things that happens, not just through you know, sexual abuse, but just happens through abuse, is that you're telling that child you are valueless. Mm-hmm. And so we are reinforcing. So here we are over at Royal Family Kids. Royal Family Kids has the same exact message, different method, but same message as Epic has, and that's to offer to these kids the challenge. You are worth having values. It's worth the risk to have values. You are a valuable person. And people are coming from all different kinds of places. It's why you heard Pastor Stephen talk about wildflowers. And what's that class about? It's about people who never have disconnected the connections that were made in their life through early sexual abuse, that you are a person who can't afford to have values. I mean, we're trying to rewire that for adult women who have already suffered that. We're trying to intervene with kids that have found themselves in difficult home situations or are now in the foster care system. We're trying to intervene into the thinking of kids from whatever their background is. Like you said, I mean, pray when you're scared to know God at all to raised in a Christian home.
Well, and a lot of these kids, you know, we realize we have a voice with them, and we take that voice very seriously. So what is the greatest impact we can have each day with them? And one of the things we do talk about is boundaries and relationships. What does a healthy relationship look like? What does an unhealthy relationship look like? To what are some of the dangers and warning signs of sex trafficking? I mean, even realizing that our young women are being preyed upon. How can we help give them some tools and skills that would be able to be used? So we want the students to walk away from this with practical things that they can put into play right away.
Sure. And Epic is not just for the kids that were like me. Because there's a lot of kids that we come across who are like, yeah, I think that's a good idea. I don't know how to actually do it. I mean, abstinence is easier said than done. Even when, you know, like when I was here, I wanted to be abstinent. I truly did. But I didn't know how to handle those situations that I didn't know what to say, what steps I could do. So out of just lack of tools, I ended up in a lot of situations that I wish I wouldn't have. And, you know, done a lot of things I regret just for lack of tools. So we take that really seriously too, equipping kids to not only make the good decisions for themselves, but to be contagious with that, you know, to be a positive influence on the people around them and to invest in the character of their own selves and their friends to help further the, you know, destinies of the people in their lives and to help be a support network for each other. So the program is really designed for all kids, and yeah.
Good, good. So I'm going to kick into a little pastor mode place, and I'm going to tell every one of you that your care group should duplicate this story. As great as it is for you to get together as a group of Christians and like each other and have fun, I would really challenge you to make your care group a small functioning reality of the kingdom of God that goes beyond fun and fellowship and goes to this place of saying, let's find some people who don't know that they could live another way, and let's invite them in. Let's make them a part. I think that's just a huge challenge for us. I think we need to do that. And if it's okay, we didn't talk about this, but if it's okay, in a minute, I'd like to ask you to pray and to pray for people who are somewhere on the road of the struggle you are on. So whether it's somebody who's in their 50s who has never disconnected the bad connections of you're worthless, you're not worth loving, you're not worth protecting, you're not worth trust, being trustworthy, you're not that kind of person. So just kind of sit in the back and try to, you know, not cause problems. To the person who's 15, on the verge of making really bad decisions because they don't get that they're worth having values, that God would help us heal those things. So forgive me, I'm locked into Forgiven and Set Free because that's what we called it for so long, Journey. So whether it's a Journey class post-abortion, whether it's Wildflowers post-sexual abuse, whether it's Royal Family Kids, whether it's the Epic in the classroom, we're driving toward the same goal here. We're headed toward the same place. We're just coming onto the road on different on-ramps, but we're headed in the same place. And I'd like to have us just pray for people that are on the journey that need to find the answers that God has for them. So would you mind just praying for us?
Right now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool, thanks.
Heavenly Father, we are so honored to be here with you today, God. I'm so honored to be back in this room where you met me, where you touched me, God. I thank you so much. I thank you so much for this church body and how they saved me. I thank you, God. And I'm so thankful that you are so good and so big that the seeds we plant, we can trust you with. God, we know that you do great things. Lord, I pray that for every person in this room, Lord, that feels their heart touched. It says, I can identify with that piece of what was said today. Let that be a seed right there, God. We're trusting you. We're asking you to to blossom that seed right now, Father, to activate that pull in their heart. To do something, to take that step of faith, that today is the day. And it's okay that that doesn't change everything. It's okay that we don't feel totally equipped to handle the world. It's okay that we know we're going to make 1,000 more mistakes. But today, I'm going to take a step forward and say, God, I choose you in this moment. I choose to let you in. I choose to let you work in my life. And I'm reminded of a verse in Thessalonians that I've been talking to with my daughter recently, and it's about letting those moments that God speaks to you, whether that's through other people or through his word or a dream that he's given you, a song that you hear, letting those moments that God talks to you to actually change you. It's about letting your mind be renewed. And when that happens, something changes in your future. Let that be it today. Let this be something that truly changes your course. And I'm not asking you to change your whole life and every single thing in it. I'm asking you to change that one degree. Say, today I want to make that slight change in my life that I'm going to trust God's going to get me in another direction. Lord, I just ask that you bless this and just rain down your blessing on these people, God. Touch the hearts of parents right now, Father, that they will feel brave to talk to their kids, to notice, to be there even when they feel rejected, to become equipped, God, that they won't give up on their kids, that they'll take every opportunity. We thank you for your power, God. We thank you that we get to partner with you. What an honor, God. What an honor. Thank you that prayers do have power. And as we can intercede for these youth, Father, and into their futures, and we choose right now as a body, God, to look at each other through your eyes. Not as projects, but truly see them. Truly see them for the beautiful creations that you've meant them to be, God, as contagious, beautiful people. And church, you don't have to be perfect to be contagious. You just gotta love each other. So, Lord, we'd invite you. We invite you to overcome us. We give you our bodies and our voices and our minds. We give you our plans. We give you our day, Father. Please use us to inspire each other, to motivate each other, to forgive each other. We want to be you with skin on today, God. Please use us. We submit everything to you with joy, because we know that you will do better than us. You working through us is what changes the world, God. And again, we're just so thankful and so humbled to be a part of your grand plan. We thank you for this body. We thank you for Pastor Dennis. Lord, thank you so much for using this place. Lord, in your precious name, we say amen. And if anyone would like to pray with Robin or I, we're both available after church today.
Yay, thank you. Thanks for praying. I could have used some of that too myself. today. You guys hogged it all. Hey, as you're leaving today, some opportunities to help with the pregnancy care center. So, in your next step cards that are in your bulletin, there's a place there for you to sign up. And if you want to become a part, you guys are going to be out at the table as well. There'll be some people out there. So a couple of things. What they do isn't free, from the utilities at their office to salaries for people that are working. So they have these bottles, and you can pick up the bottles and put really big checks in them.
and then you can come and put them back here in the little playpen. And we're going to be collecting these over the next couple of weeks. We'd like to get them back. Some of you are notorious for bringing them back in October. We appreciate that, but if you could wrap it up in the next few weeks, it would be nice. There's some ways for you to be involved. So you can mark on your next step card. You can grab one of these bottles as you're leaving today. They're going to be out at the table there so that you can connect. As Brittany said, they're going to be available for prayer. I want to encourage you, if what you have heard today has kind of challenged you, to maybe look at that next step for yourself and to say, okay, it's my leap of faith. You need to let some people know what you're doing. Because without that information, it's really hard for us to come around and hard for us to help in some way. So when Brittany took that leap of faith and said, okay, I got to quit, I remember that Sunday when that happened. But because you let us know you were making that decision, it let us know that we needed to respond to that. We needed, like Jesus, to respond to your step of faith. And the care group would have never showed up, and you'd have never gotten that tip if we hadn't known what you were doing. So if you live in the dark, the rest of us are hard. It's hard for the rest of us to see. So tell somebody the decision that you made this morning, okay? Tell somebody the decision that you made. So thanks, ladies, for coming. This has been amazing. Thanks, Brittany. This has been the best presentation I've made all year. Letting you talk. Thank you very much for that.
I did want to mention, I don't know if we mentioned that, in case you guys don't know, everything we do at Pregnancy Care Center, we do for free for the community. So that's why we rely on you guys so heavily, because we don't charge for anything. So.
Yeah, yeah. So we're gonna support you, and we're gonna do that. So the ushers are gonna come. They're gonna collect your next step cards, and there's been several times through the service where we've mentioned those cards and an opportunity for you to respond, from signing up for Braden's plan to signing up with the Pregnancy Care Center to putting your prayer requests in. That's why we collect these. We collect the offering so that we can keep the lights on. So that's a pretty straightforward kind of thing. So I think you get that, and so those things are gonna be there. I want to invite Nick and Jamie. We're going to transition kind of now to the next part of the day, which is lunch. So today comes with free lunch. What a deal. We're doing that because Jamie likes a party, and so we're going to go have a party. And parties are always better with food. So first of all, this is a little gift from us at Parkway to you guys. For those of you that don't know what's in here, do you know what's in here? Well, you get to go out of town, and you get to spend a few nights together, and you get to have fun and do some things together, kind of away from, you know, your responsibilities and the pressure of all of that. So get some time off at work, yeah, so that you can do that. But that's just kind of a gift and just a way of saying that we appreciate you. But again, knowing you and kind of your personality, we're just going to go hang out with you and have lunch. And some of you brought cards. I saw you signing cards and doing things this morning. Some of you have done that. And some of you just want to say some things to her and say thanks for the work that she did. And some of the students want to honor you, whatever. However that works, it's just going to be casual. So do you know where the whole center is? Go out the door and hang a left. It's the building farthest that direction from here, back to the east. So just out the door, hang a left, and go to the whole center. It's the biggest room we have outside of this one, and that's where the food's going to be. And please, come and enjoy us, okay? Because we bought the food already, figuring you were going to come, all right? So come on over and have lunch with us, and we just want to take that opportunity to say thanks. And I think did some of your family show up? Did they make it? Your parents are up there, up in the balcony. What are you doing up there? Oh, my goodness. That's as far away as you can get without being outside. You're in the very back row, right? Way to be supportive, you know? We're gonna let you guys go first so that you can kind of get over there. Then we're going to come over and join you. But we want to just pray for you guys as we kind of transition to lunch. And it'll be our prayer for lunch as well. So, Father, thank you again for Nick and for Jamie and for Jamie's service here in these years in youth ministry. I thank you for that. I thank you for the transitions that you're calling them to. I thank you, Father, for what lies ahead for them. I thank you, Father, that this is not an end. It truly is a transition. It just moves ministry from one form to another. It moves life priorities from one set of priorities to a slightly different set of priorities. I thank you, Father, that you brought them together. That's been a part of this journey, because it was a Jamie by herself thing, and now it's a Nick and Jamie thing. And so we're thankful for that and how you brought them together, and we're thankful for their lives and how they're going to continue to share with us and grow in ministry here. And thank you that we get to celebrate that. I thank you, God, that along the way we get to celebrate, because that makes life a little easier to get through. So thanks for today, and thanks for celebration, and thanks that we get to do this. And thanks for the food, because it's going to be good. Amen. Amen. Bless you guys. We're going to see you over there. Okay? God bless you.